if you get a teacher able to teach their specialization to a group of kids that can be anywhere in the world that can join that class by just putting a headset on and then look the teacher straight in the eye, ask questions, teacher can take them on a magical journey to, you know, see something that they could never see in real life, you got to convince me that that doesn't take off very quickly as soon as these devices are available for those teachers and students to put on.
I'm currently with Philip Rosedale, co-founder of High Fidelity, at their San Francisco office here today. So Philip, how's it going?
It's going great. This is our new office just moving into in the next few days.
Congratulations. This place is amazing. It's huge.
It is big. Yeah, it's room for about 100 of us, and we're just a little over half of that right now, so we're hoping to grow pretty quickly here.
So with virtual reality, how close are we for this to be adopted into the everyday lives of the masses out there, and when do you see that happening?
Well, you know, a lot of the stuff that we've done with VR so far, or I should say the whole industry has done, has kind of been these demos. You know, there have been a lot of single player experiences, a lot of gaming.
Right.
I think there's two things that have to happen for VR to go where I want it to go. The first thing is the hardware has to get portable and it has to get inexpensive. This next year, 2019, we're going to have three products on the market, one from Oculus, another one from HTC, Vive, another one from Lenovo and other Google, you know, based Daydream-based devices, and these devices are going to cost what a smartphone costs. Oculus has said its device is going to cost $400, and it's going to give you all the power that you've seen in the best experience that you've had in VR so far. But those experiences have been tethered with a wire to a PC, and this is going to be a thing like a baseball cap you put on, and you can walk around. You can walk around in an auditorium and the thing will track you every step of the way. So the first thing is we got to get an inexpensive device that's like a smartphone that everybody can buy and have a reason to buy. The second thing is companies like myself, like High Fidelity, have to build the platform software so that people can do any kind of experience and get a bunch of people into that experience quickly. And that's going to enable things like teachers teaching students all over the world. In one classroom, taking them on a trip to Mars, doing things like that. And that's going to happen starting next year as we get these inexpensive headsets.
And talking about events, you guys have a big event next Saturday, Future VR. So that's going to be huge. And you've been building out, so you gave us an exclusive look to what the lay of the land is going to be for that. What can we expect of this big event?
Yeah, I mean, we've been doing these load tests, as you know, over the last couple of quarters, and we got up to about 430 people in one space a couple weeks ago. And based on that, we said, hey, wait a second, that's enough people. That's enough people to have a show. So, Future Lands is this event that's going to have a bunch of things, some great music playing, some great live music, some contests. For like Avatar, you know, walking the red carpet. We're going to do a lot of different things, but our general idea is just, you know, people all over the world being able to come together and feel like they're face to face. There's got to be a festival format that's going to take up here. You know, we're platform software makers, but we're going to do a few of these things just to get people excited and have them hopefully start copying us and stealing our ideas and, you know, bringing this whole industry to life.
Opening it up as well for the masses. So what is the world record for the amount of people at a VR event? What is the world record?
Well, in terms of people actually able to see and hear each other, it's definitely ours of a couple weeks ago. There's no way anybody's ever had more than 400 moving, speaking avatars in one space, to my knowledge, and I've written about it and asked people to tell me, and I haven't heard anything. You know, in terms of people being in like a video game together, sure, you can get like thousands of people wandering around a server in a game like World of Warcraft, but as I say, they can't all see and hear each other at the same time. So this idea of how many people can be together in one place is one that I think we're breaking ground on, and my hope, you know, next year is, you know, we'll get to thousands and beyond, so you'll be able to do anything you want in these environments.
And what are you guys really working on in regards to mass applications out there? So, I mean, there's so many different applications for VR as a whole. You've got business trips. You no longer have to get on an airplane and go and stay in a hotel. What do you think is going to be adopted the quickest? Would it be the education? Would it be, what application do you see?
I think education is actually going to be a real runner. I mean, people may not find that as exciting as video games, but what I like to say is the video game market is about $100 billion. Now, that's big. It's doubled in size over the past few years because of mobile. But the education market worldwide is more than $6 trillion. So it's 60 times bigger. And if you get a teacher able to teach their specialization to a group of kids that can be anywhere in the world that can join that class by just putting a headset on and then look the teacher straight in the eye, ask questions. Teacher can take them on a magical journey to, you know, see something that they could never see in real life. You got to convince me that that doesn't take off very quickly as soon as these devices are available for those teachers and students to put on.
And how far away do you think we are from that becoming a reality?
Well, I think we're going to see some really interesting classes starting up next year as people start to buy these headsets. I mean, I know that we'll be in the same way, you're standing in this space here where we do experimental studio work, you know, whether it's music events or teaching, we basically put, you know, a bunch of kids, a bunch of people in headsets together at the same time. As soon as these headsets come out, I'm going to be buying, you know, hundreds of them and giving them away to people, you know, just to get these sorts of classes going and see what we can do.
That's amazing.
But so next year,
we're you'll be going into the schools as well. Well, someone from the high fidelity staff will be going in and really helping people understand and the ease of use as well for VR.
Yeah, you know, I think that there's going to be, just like we saw with Second Life, which still has this big economy, you know, $600 million a year economy, I think we'll see that there's going to be a lot of entrepreneurial kind of eBay-like efforts that go on. So around education, I'm less concerned actually about, you know, getting a school district in San Francisco to adopt this stuff. I think that's going to take a while. But what I'm saying, I think we're going to start seeing next year is you're definitely going to see the article about the geologist, you know, who's like, you know, a volcanic geologist, and she's basically doing a Thursday night special, you know, for kids that are interested in geology, right? And she's taking them on a, you know, into a 3D model of a volcano, right?
Yeah.
That's, you're going to see those videos and those classes starting up next year as these headsets come out. That's what I think you're going to see.
That's amazing. My last question there, Philip, is the privacy side of things, which we kind of briefly mentioned. What are your views on that? What do you feel we need to be aware of when people start really adopting VR? What do they need to be thinking about?
Well, here's the thing. When you put one of these headsets on, you are giving up, or the headset has access to information about you that you're just not even thinking about right now. You know, everything you say, but the way you move your head, where you're looking, where you walk. Of course, that thing's got a GPS on it, so it knows where you are in most cases. So this data about you when you're wearing these devices is represents a very dangerous and very invasive, you know, invasion of privacy. And so as an industry, we've got to evolve standards that are better than the ones we had with the internet for securing this privacy. And we had a event just yesterday where we brought a bunch of industry leaders together and talked about it, and some scientists and leaders of the, you know, many companies that are working on VR. And everybody was of a shared opinion, which delighted me, that we are at the edge of a very big thing happening here, and we do all need to be respectful of the privacy of the people using these things. And in fact, we have to really do some, make some hard design choices now about, like, the business models. You know, the business models for VR, they can't be just free ad driven, because that means that I've got to collect this data to make any money.
Right.
And if I collect a little bit of data on you, trust me, I'm collecting too much. You're in danger. You know, it's not stuff you want me to have.
And you're talking about being able to diagnose certain things as well, which that blew my mind when you mentioned that.
Yeah, just through the motion of your body, of your head and your hands and your eyes, we can diagnose conditions, like psychological conditions like ADHD, certainly whether you're interested in things, whether you're paying attention. So this is an information that I think can be part of anybody's business model.
No, I agree. Well, listen, thank you so much for taking the time to come on today. And thank you for welcoming us in your brand new office. Congratulations. This place is kicking.
Well, it's a mess right now, but I think in a couple of months, this is going to be quite a showcase.
We'll be back for that. Don't worry. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Charles.